Давайте перейдем к Елизавете Ехимовой. Нижний Новгород, Россия. Comparative analysis of advertising campaigns mentioning the theme of the Holocaust in Israel and the Baltic countries. Пожалуйста.
So, good afternoon. The point is that I plan to speak English and I will do this. So, nowadays high and serious attention is paid to the problem of Holocaust denial, but usually only the formal level of regard is taken into account. However, the information field of different countries, including the State of Israel and the Baltic states, is full of information indirectly connected with the Holocaust. So the aim of this study is to identify specific features of our advertising campaigns united by one common feature, using Holocaust imagery materials. So I'd like to devote my speech into two parts, and I plan to show you some visuals. So speaking about the Holocaust imagery in our commercial, I would like to draw your attention to three cases. The first one took place in Israel in 2007 when a famous woman clothing stores industry, Dan Cassidy, used in their advertising campaign of the new summer collection, Holocaust imagery, and this action, you could see this on the first picture, caused a firestorm of criticism, and the company was not ready for it, but later in the official explanation made by the press secretary to all the concerned organizations, they said that this campaign was not generally aimed at promotion of clothers, but in general they wanted to highlight the problem of Holocaust denial that became known to them. After speaking to several Jewish models from Western Europe, they understood that these young people don't even know about this problem. Two more cases took place in 2012 in Estonia. The first one is connected with Garrett Sturm company. It's the second picture. They posted on their website a photo of the gates of the Auschwitz concentration camp with the notorious wrought iron work makes you free inscription. And firstly, they tried to turn the story into humor, but later their director said that the action was not random and that it was planned and that their main aim was to prove that natural gas is not poisonous and it could be used for heating and for heating of different premises, including the buildings with dramatic history. That's a quotation of his speech. So, and one more case took place also in 2012 in October when ST Express published it's a newspaper, an Estonian newspaper, published an advertising of weight loss pills using the name of Dr. Mengele and the Buchenwald concentration camp. And in their explanation, they said that the action was aimed to spoof the previous case, the case of the gas storm, and they generally did not warrant to do some actions connected with Holocaust denial or some problems with the Holocaust commemoration. So the second part is devoted to election propaganda materials. Unfortunately, the scope of proliferation of Holocaust imagery is not only limited to the sphere of economy. But the sphere of politics presupposes great responsibility and in general should eliminate such a remarkable mistake as Leap Before You Look. So here we should also find several cases. In Israel there are several of them. The first one took place in 2004 when our Kach movements are used in their our campaign are supporting the settlement activity, also some Holocaust imagery materials. Unfortunately, I didn't find the exact picture to show you. The next case indirectly connected with the topic and the analysis took place during the election campaign of 2009. When during the running for the seats in the 18th Knesset, there was a very strange political alliance of the Holocaust Survivors Movement and a part of LA Rock Party under the title the Holocaust Survivors and Grown Up Green Leaf Party. And there were two items in their political agenda. The first one, the improvement of living conditions of the Holocaust survivors, and the second one, surprisingly, legalization of cannabis consumption, because the official aim of LA Rock exactly this one. So this political union was caused only wonder and disappointment. The party was not connected at all, wasn't supported at all during the elections, and they didn't overcome the threshold. So in the last case in Israel took place during the recent election campaign when Likudniki, that's a group of unofficial supporters of one of the biggest Israeli political parties, posted on their website some information aimed at drawing away the attention of the electorate from the Israeli Home Party and their leader, Naftali Bennett. So they posted on their website his image under behind barbed wire and a short text, you can see it on the screen, where they compared the Jewish Home Party with the Jewish ghetto. So firstly, the party Likud and this organization Likudniki negated all the connections, but later an indisputable link between them was found, because these ads were sponsored by one of the members of Likud. His name is Moshe Forgan. He was placed 19-6 on the party Knesset list. So, and the story was resulted in his expulsion from the party list during the elections, and also during these elections. Despite, instead of accepted or expected failure, Jewish Home Party got some extra votes after this case. Similar materials were revealed during the recent election campaign in Lithuania. So in 2012, the Lithuanian Nationalist Union used such materials. The first group of publications is connected with the candidate Marius Galivarinis. He appeared on the party poster wearing a swastika-decorated tie, and it also caused a firestorm of criticism. And the second member, Julius Spanker, on some publications called for being against of the government's decision to pay compensation to Jewish organizations for a nationalized property owned by the Jewish community during the war. So these candidates also were not elected during the recent election campaign. So as a result, as we can see, the theme of the Jewish catastrophe is still deep down in hearts and minds of people all over the world. But when such cases took place, of course, governments need to respond to such publications, but here the authorities usually are suffering from the lack of experience sharing. In case of Israel, we can see some steps used in case the government needs to give their response. Firstly, formal protests of the Jewish organizations in Israel, sometimes they are supported by different organizations abroad. The demand for a clear and strong statement from the administration of organizations responsible for such publications, and direct or indirect involvement of the government. In case of such Baltic states as Estonia and Lithuania, we can see that are some steps of this strategy, if we can say so, usually lost. Of course, governments try to respond, but it usually representatives of the organizations responsible for these publications try to sidestep the direct answer and to avoid official apologies. Of course, the involvement of media is inevitable in both cases, but in case of the Baltic states, we also can find some phenomena that is connected with the fact that very often after such publications, political myths can appear. Usually, media are not using exactly the theme of the colorists, understanding all the dramatic circumstances, but they're usually speculating with ends and means, and as a result, such political myths as our stories about the necessity of the topic of the Holocaust are in such publications for the elections in the USA or for Russian natural gas prices may appear in media. So to sum up, I'd like to underline that my speech was not just aimed at the showing that how the Holocaust imagery used for political purposes or to offer gaining benefit. That's about collective memory, and we should always take into account that it's more than needs or commercial and election campaigns presuppose that people use different sources of information, and if such materials appear there and nothing is done, bold initiatives may be introduced. So despite certain equivalency between Israel and the Baltic states in this regard, the former undertakes more obvious measures to stop such activities. But if in the sphere of economy, these materials are immediately prohibited. In election propaganda materials, such publications are still used. It means that political subcontext that has historically been predominant is still important. The only possible way to stop such publications and such activities is to turn the incidents mentioned above into the opportunity for experience sharing between authorities and education for the next generations. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. The questions to Elizaveta. Yeah. To.
Елизавета, спасибо большое за интересный доклад. Я себе позволю задать вопрос все-таки на русском языке. Очень интересный действительно подход, но мне кажется, не осветили вы один аспект. Да, какова была все-таки реакция общества, да, на публикацию, например, в Эстонии этой рекламы? Да? Как-то это в интернете были какие-то комментарии, обсуждения по этому поводу? Или же, насколько я понимаю, вот эта литовская партия, она, видимо, легальная, и она баллотировалась в парламент.
Она баллотировалась, да?
Какой,
да.
Какой процент, да, получила эта партия? Да? То есть какую поддержку общества имеет она?
Отвечая на первый вопрос по поводу реакции общества, ну, разумеется, реакция большинства, она в любом случае будет негативной, потому что в нормальных обществах принять подобные публикации, независимо от национальной принадлежности, от гражданства, все-таки это несколько не совсем то, что может быть. Поэтому общая реакция, она была все-таки негативной. И, разумеется, есть интернет, есть большое количество социальных сетей, где просто невозможно отслеживать реакции, отслеживать публикации. Разумеется, там можно было найти и поддержку, и высказывание против, но это просто особенность источника. Все-таки, в общем, общество это осудило. И даже было, по-моему, если я не ошибаюсь, официальное заявление от правительства. То, что касается поддержки партии, о которой вы спрашивали, то здесь все-таки необходимо принять во внимание особенности избирательного процесса в стране, потому что там сочетаются выборы по партийным спискам и по одномандатным округам, и союз был сформирован исключительно на время проведения выборов. То есть это не совсем партия. Они изначально принадлежали к нескольким разным националистическим движениям, но перед выборами они все-таки сделали выбор в пользу того, чтобы идти на выборы вместе. И из той информации, которая существует сегодня, можно просто обратиться к списку действующего правительства, там нет этих кандидатов. Конкретно как вот это распределялось, к сожалению, не могу ответить на этот вопрос.
Thank you for your presentation. Just one question. As I understood, you tried to compare the situation in Israel and in the Baltic states.
Yeah.
And do you see the Baltic states as a region without any big differences? Because I didn't manage to identify you mentioning Latvia in your abstract or in your presentation. So are there any differences in Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, because your results are on Baltic states?
Yeah. Okay, so speaking about differences, of course, it may be found, and the point is that in Estonia I found only election propaganda materials, and I told about in Estonia I found only information about the sphere of economy. In Lithuania I found only election propaganda materials. So we can say that it's in Estonia the first is more proliferated, in Lithuania the second one. Speaking about the case of Latvia, generally speaking, I didn't find such publications in English-speaking or in Russian-speaking newspapers. Maybe there are some in some local newspapers, so. And the case of Latvia was not mentioned here. So maybe you are right, I should highlight it somehow in the title that I will be comparing only these three countries. Thank you.
Okay. Спасибо большое, Света.